This is Psych Boost, helping you with your psychology qualification one video at a time. This video is on memory, and in this third video, we'll be covering memory as an active process. The very kind support of students and teachers who donate on Patreon help me help you by continuing to make these videos and resources. A very big thank you for your help, guys. To join them, follow the link. For everyone, you might want to check out the free worksheet for this video and the quiz. So, I imagine you're here to study GCSE psychology. So here are the terms on the AQA GCSE specification we're going to cover in this video. As we go through the video, they will be in red text. You need to be able to respond to all of this. So before I start the content of this video, I've got a story to tell you. What I'd like you to do when I reveal it is to pause the video and read the whole story. So that story you just read was originally used by a psychologist called Bartlett back in 1932. He told the story to his participants, and then he got them to recall it back to him. Now, it'll be best if you wait 15 minutes, so maybe pause the video again, get a drink, and then come back. If you're back, I want you to take some notes about what you remember from the story. You don't have to write it out in full, but make some bullet point notes about some of the key facts. So let's carry on with the video. Many people think that memories are like a recording, that you can just play them back like a video. But Bartlett disagreed with that idea. He thought memory was reconstructive. When we remember, we recreate our memories using what we know about the world. Now, there's a really important term I'm going to use a few times across these videos, and it's called a schema. Now, these are packages of information about objects in the world, and we use them kind of as a mental shortcut. Now, Bartlett thought we use them when we recall our memories. Bartlett's aim was to test his theory of reconstructive memory by showing how recall is influenced by cultural schemas. Bartlett's method was to tell the story at the start of this video. It was called The War of the Ghosts, and he told it to English participants. Now, being a Native American story, Bartlett was confident it was very unfamiliar to his participants. Then, using a process called serial recall, Bartlett asked the participants to retell the story, with gaps in time between 15 minutes and 10 years. So, the results were his participants would remember the overall meaning of the story, but not accurately. Often participants would leave out details, omissions, that would shorten the story. They also changed some parts of the story. A common change was remembering boats, not canoes. The participants would also make rationalizations. That means they would change parts of the story so it would make more sense to them. On the basis of these results, Bartlett concluded that memory is actively reconstructed, and memories are changed to match schema. Now we've talked through Bartlett's study, let's look in a little more detail about his theory and his ideas. So let's start with the term reconstructive memory. We would say it's an active process. We bring small remembered parts together and create a memory that isn't accurate. A normal view of memory would be passive, that we just play back the memory in our mind. Not only do we make memories from small parts, but we change parts of memories and fill in gaps in our memory so the memory makes sense to us. This is based on the schema that we have. Bartlett also used the term effort after meaning. Now this suggests that we do remember the overall meaning of a memory, but then we use mental effort to interpret that memory so it matches our cultural expectations. So a good example is in Bartlett's original study, many of those participants would change the canoes in the story to boats. So let's evaluate Bartlett's study. His research with the War of the Ghost story provided evidence that memory is reconstructive, with participants performing effort after meaning, changing the story so it made sense from their cultural viewpoint. However, it seems that not all memories are reconstructed. Memories like your first day at school, so those with an emotional significance, do seem to be accurately recorded. The War of the Ghost study wasn't significant to the participants, so maybe Bartlett's study doesn't tell us how memory is used in everyday life. But knowing the limitations of memory, and that recall can be distorted by schema, can be applied to the real world, especially eyewitness testimony. Talking about the accuracy of memory, let's look at three factors that are thought to influence how correct your recall is: interference, context, and false memories. When we say interference, we mean there are two memories and one memory is making the recall of the other one more difficult. So there are two types of interference, proactive and retroactive. Let's run through those real quick. Proactive interference is when old information influences the recall of new information. Say if you move house and you give your old postcode instead of your new one. So clearly the opposite to this is retroactive interference. This is when new information affects the recall of old information. So if I was going to give you an example, let's say you had a bank card and you have a PIN number for it. You get a second bank card, but then learning that new PIN makes you struggle to remember the PIN on your older card. Now, I'm not sure if they're the greatest examples for you, but if you can think of better ones, please put them in the comment section. Let's move on to context. It's an interesting one. Recall seems to be more accurate if you learn and recall the information in the same location. It's for aspects of the environment can act as a kind of trigger for that information. Now, false memories are memories that feel true but didn't actually happen. We can explain them as maybe implanted. This can sometimes happen in therapy where people are asked to recall their earliest memories. Another explanation is, as we've explained, memory is reconstructive. Let's consider an evaluation for each of these factors affecting the accuracy of memory. There's research evidence by Schmidt showing that the more time someone moved house, the more difficult it was to remember the street names around their childhood home. So I guess Homer was right when he said,
"Every time I learn something new, it pushes some old stuff out of my brain."
Supporting context as a factor, researchers Godden and Badley found that when they tested the recall of information in divers, information that was learned underwater was recalled best underwater. And if they learned the information on land, they recalled it best on land. And research on false memories has practical applications to how police and law courts should treat eyewitnesses. Trust and recall less than maybe other forms of evidence. However, much of the research on the limitations of memory have been conducted in artificial environments using very unnatural activities. So the findings of these studies may not really apply to how we use memory in the real world, or memory's limitations. Now that we've covered the content, you need to be able to use all that information to actually answer questions. So here are five questions I've made to test your skills. So pause the video and give them a go. For those of you who support me on Patreon, I've put together an additional video showing you how to answer these properly. For everybody else, thanks for watching, like, subscribe, see you in the next video on perception, visual illusions.